Okay, let's open our Bibles to Ezra chapter 4 once again. Last time we read the letter which was sent to King Artaxerxes, the king of the Persian Empire, concerning the Jews' rebuilding of their temple. And this was done to undermine the rebuilding and bring it to a halt. This was done by enemies of the Jews, enemies of Jerusalem and Israel, who were nothing but anti-Semites and Jew haters. Now we're going to read the reply sent back to them by King Artaxerxes in verses 17 through 22. Ezra 4, and let's start there at verse 17. Then sent the king an answer unto Rehum the chancellor, and to Shimshai the scribe, and to the rest of their companions that dwell in Samaria, and unto the rest beyond the river, peace, and at such a time. The letter which ye sent unto us hath been plainly read before me, and I commanded, and search hath been made, and it is found that this city of old time hath made insurrection against kings, and that rebellion and sedition have been made therein. There have been mighty kings also over Jerusalem, which have ruled over all countries beyond the river, and toll, tribute, and custom was paid unto them. Give ye now commandment to cause these men to cease, and that this city be not builded, until another commandment shall be given from me. Take heed now that ye fail not to do this. Why should damage grow to the hurt of the kings? Part of what Israel's enemies wrote about Jerusalem was actually true. For example, go back to the book of 2 Kings, chapter 24. 2 Kings 24. And we'll begin there at verse 18, down through chapter 25 and verse 1. 2 Kings 24, starting at verse 18. Zedekiah was 21 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned 11 years in Jerusalem. And his mother's name was Hamutal, the daughter of Jeremiah of Libna. And he did that which was evil in the sight of the Lord, according to all that Jehoiakim had done. For through the anger of the Lord it came to pass in Jerusalem and Judah, until he had cast them out from his presence, that Zedekiah rebelled against the king of Babylon. And it came to pass in the ninth year of his reign, in the tenth month, in the tenth day of the month, that Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came, he and all his host, against Jerusalem, and pitched against it, and they built forts against it round about. When the man of sin sets up himself and leads the UN from Jerusalem, claiming that he is God and demands worship, that city at that time, called the Great City, at that time is likened to Sodom and Egypt, Revelation 11, verse 8. Two corrupt societies in the Bible's history and in the ancient world. In fact, this sort of dual nature of Jerusalem, Jerusalem being named, being meaning the city of peace, and yet this dual nature of its city and its history has caused some modern-day critics to confound Jerusalem with Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots, Revelation chapter 17. But, of course, that cannot be, because at the end of the tribulation and the return of Christ, Jerusalem is restored to being called the beloved city, Revelation 20, verse 9. And Babylon the Great is destroyed completely, Revelation 18 and verse 21. So the king makes a search of Israel's past in verse 19 tonight, and he finds out that indeed many of the charges that the Samaritans had brought against Israel were confirmed. She had indeed been guilty of insurrection and rebellion and sedition, as verse 19 has it. But Jerusalem also had enjoyed mighty kings, David, Solomon, Hezekiah. Recall Josiah, who was, I think, 8 years old when he began to be king. So Israel had great kings as well, who had extracted, where it says, toll, tribute, and custom, verse 20, from those nations which Israel had conquered, which is what all kings do, which is what all conquering countries did, to extract toll and tribute and custom tax those countries which they had conquered. So Israel's enemies win the first round in bringing the rebuilding of the city and the temple to a halt and stop the Jews' progress. They were able to do this by ignoring King Cyrus' decree, the record of his decree, which was undoubtedly stored in the same place as the archives of Israel's past, well before their Babylonian captivity. And this was undoubtedly the case because a later king, Darius, finds the missing correspondence, which these Samaritans had conveniently overlooked, tried to ignore, and act as though it hadn't occurred. Look forward at Ezra 6, and by this he turns the plans of Israel's enemies upside down. Israel 6, and the first three verses there. Then Darius the king made a decree, and search was made in the house of the rolls where the treasures were laid up in Babylon. And there was found at Akmatha, in the palace that is in the province of the Medes, a roll. And therein was a record thus written: in the first year of Cyrus the king of, the same Cyrus the king made a decree concerning the house of God at Jerusalem. Let the house be builded, the place where they offered sacrifices, and let the foundations thereof be strongly laid, the height thereof 70 cubits, and the breadth thereof 70 cubits, and verse 4, so forth and so on. But back to our... So by that, King Darius later reverses the fortunes of Israel and undoes the work of their enemies in trying to halt the rebuilding, of the temple, and halt the rebuilding of the city. It's amazing to me how, even in modern days, certain societies, I'm not going to mention anyone in particular, but certain societies want to intrude into other more productive and more prosperous societies and simply take it from them. Not warfare, but immigration, E-M-I-G-R-A-T-I-O-N, immigrate into countries where they weren't even invited. And it's by sheer growth and outnumbering the people who built that society, say, we want it too. Give it to us. We weren't smart enough to build anything like it in our own homeland. And this is happening right now in Israel, more so than any other country. The Palestinians there live within the territory that belongs to the state of Israel. But you hear and read letters, you hear people on the radio and television, you read letters, the poor Palestinians and Jews are continuing to build settlements in Palestinians' land. That's not the Palestinians' land. It's the state of Israel's land. Amen. The Palestinians are fortunate to be living there under Israeli government. But the same, similar scenarios have been playing out. It's a major issue right now in the United States concerning immigration from all over the world. Societies that were impoverished because of perhaps their own lack of ingenuity or their lack of education or bad politics or all of those things wanting to simply overpopulate the native citizens and then take away from them what the citizens had built. What's going on here in the U.S., and I don't mean just Mexico here in California. This is going on all over the country. Some of those immigration groups immigrating are more industrious than others. I'll grant that. We can certainly admit that. But the idea that that society built what we couldn't build and weren't smart enough to build, we simply moved there. Eventually, we can take it over and take it away from them. It's happening in France with Muslim immigration, happening in England with Muslim immigration. I said I wasn't going to mention groups by name, but, you know, it's happening, and we see it and hear about it all the time. And here you have people who didn't build anything while the Jews were captives under Babylon. And the Jews come back, and they begin to rebuild the ruins of their old cities and the walls of their capital city and the temple that they worship God at. And the Bible says in Proverbs 6, "For jealousy is the rage of a man." Now, that context there is a jealous husband who whose anger can't be assuaged no matter what the fellow that was, you know, romancing his wife tries to do. He can't buy off his anger. He's not going to rest until he gets revenge. But the same principle can apply to societies and people all over the world. Jealousy is the rage of the lunatics in the United States whose candidate lost the presidential election 2 years ago. So jealousy is the rage of men and women. And when you don't get your way, it's amazing to me that one of our major political parties in this country behave like four-year-olds and aren't getting their way. When they want to change something, they don't go through the legislation or the ballot box and try to persuade the citizens to their point of view. No, they carry placards and block traffic and march in the streets and act like fools. It's amazing to watch one of the major political parties in this country and in the world behave like spoiled children who never got a spanking in their life and assume they're supposed to be given everything they want. They ought to be given spankings, well, they ought to be given. But anyway, let's move on. Now, verses 23 and 24 in our text. "Now when the copy of King Artaxerxes' letter was read before Rehum and Shimshai the scribe and their companions, they went up in haste to Jerusalem unto the Jews and made them to cease by force and power. Then ceased the work of the house of God, which is at Jerusalem. So it ceased unto the second year of the reign of Darius, king of Persia." And verse 1 of chapter 5. "Then the prophets, Haggai the prophet, and Zechariah the son of Iddo, prophesied unto the Jews that were in Judah and Jerusalem in the name of the God of Israel, even unto them." Here the Bible introduces two of the minor prophets, and what they refer to as minor prophets are simply called that because their books are much shorter than some of the larger ones, like Jeremiah and Isaiah and Ezekiel. And, here he introduces us to Zechariah and Haggai. Turn forward, if you will, to the book of Haggai. It's only two chapters, so be careful you don't go past it and miss it. Zephaniah, right between Zephaniah and Zechariah. Haggai, chapter 1, verse 1. "In the second year of Darius the king, in the sixth month, in the first day of the month, came the word of the Lord by Haggai the prophet unto Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and to Joshua, the son of Josedek, the high priest, saying." So the time frame is the same as the narrative there in Ezra 5. "Then Haggai declares the words of God to comfort the people concerning the rebuilding." Look at chapter 2, Haggai, and verses 1 through 5. In the seventh month, in the 21st day of the month, came the word of the Lord by the prophet Haggai, saying, Speak now to Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and to Joshua, the son of Josedek, the high priest, and to the residue of the people, saying, Who is left among you that saw this house in her first glory? And how do you see it now? Is it not in your eyes in comparison of it as nothing? Yet now, of course, he's referring to Solomon's temple. Yet now be strong, O Zerubbabel, saith the Lord, and be strong, O Joshua, son of Josedek, the high priest, and be strong, all ye people of the land, saith the Lord, and work, for I am with you, saith the Lord of hosts. According to the word that I covenanted with you when ye came out of Egypt, so my spirit remaineth among you, fear ye not. Hold your place here and go back, if you will, to the book of Exodus, chapter 29. Exodus 29, and just two verses there, verses 45 and 46. Here God tells them, I will dwell among the children of Israel and will be their God. And they shall know that I am the Lord their God that brought them forth out of the land of Egypt, that I may dwell among them. I am the Lord their God. I don't know how much plainer God could have stated it. When he says my people in the Old Testament, he's referring to Israel. He's referring to the tribes. He's not referring to Gentile nations or the Babylonians or the Persian Empire. He's not referring to any of these other non-Jewish peoples around Jerusalem. But back to the book of Haggai. And then the Lord gives a prophecy concerning the millennium, following that one of the rebuilding of their temple. Start there, Haggai 2, at verse 6. For thus saith the Lord of hosts, Yet once it is a little while, and I will shake the heavens, and the earth, and the sea, and the dry land. And I will shake all nations, and the desire of all nations shall come. And I will fill this house with glory, saith the Lord of hosts. The silver is mine, and the gold is mine, saith the Lord of hosts. Glory of this latter house shall be greater than the former, saith the Lord of hosts. And in this place will I give peace, saith the Lord of hosts. Haggai predicts that there will eventually come the thing that every country represented at the United Nations wants, there in verse 19. That is peace. That's what they claim they want. But it will come first at the city of peace, which is what the name Jerusalem means. And second, it won't come about by the plans or the actions of any Gentile nations. You know, ever since 1948, the United Nations has been the detractor of the state of Israel. They've been trying to reverse their own history and undo what they did in granting a new nation the state of Israel. They'd been trying to nullify their own grant to the Jews and then turn it all over to the Muslims. The ultimate peace to Jerusalem will come by the Prince of Peace at the Second Advent and not before. I think we talked about this not long ago, that the city is even named the City of Peace, although there has never been any real lasting peace in that city in its history. But it is named such in anticipation of the Prince of Peace, who will rule the world in absolute righteousness from there one day. Haggai calls it the desire of all nations, verse 7. And that is peace. So it has nothing to do with the first coming of Jesus Christ. You know, since the Lord Jesus first came, no nation on earth has really desired him. Not even this one. Do you realize that in the Declaration of Independence and the U.S. Constitution and the Bill of Rights, the name Jesus Christ doesn't appear anywhere? The closest that our founders got was to refer to as God, one nation under God, without being specific. And sometimes they would refer to God as the great lawgiver of the universe. But very seldom would they mention the Lord Jesus Christ by name. Oh, perhaps in their personal correspondence with one another, they did so. As a matter of fact, I'm sure that they did so. But in the documents that were the foundation of this country, there's no mention of Jesus Christ. Do you realize long ago in the state constitution of the state of Vermont, just about all 50 states have language in their preamble that refers to rights of man given by God and so forth, which in a way you could argue that atheists were not wanted in any one of the 50 states. But the state of Vermont, once long ago in their state constitution, the preamble actually mentioned the Lord Jesus Christ as the one that they sought to please. And yet that's the first state that that approved gay marriage, as far as I can remember. And of course, those little states, New Hampshire and Vermont, neither one of those states have a million people living inside the entire state. So they weren't very influential upon the rest of the nation. However, this nation is, Abraham Lincoln said in 1863, we have forgotten God. And not only have we forgotten God as a people, turn on the Sunday morning talk shows and the news roundtables and shows of that type, and there's no mention of God. There's no mention of the interests of God or how this will affect the religious and the spiritual beliefs of Americans. Everything is simply political. The one day of the week that Americans traditionally set aside for church and worship is, you can find nary a mention of anything even religious on some of those talk shows. And a lot of good ones out there. A lot of very bright and intelligent conservative minds who I like listening to. But this nation doesn't want Jesus Christ. No nation does. Israel doesn't. As a matter of fact, Israel welcomes atheistic Jews. They welcome homosexual Jews. They welcome Jews from all over the world. But if you're a Messianic Jew, you believe that you have the Messiah, he's already come, they don't want you. They don't want you in the state of Israel. As if you could even immigrate there and they find out you're Messianic, you are regarded as a second-rate citizen. Certainly the Muslims don't want Jesus Christ. The Hindus don't want him. The Buddhists don't want him. And other pagan parts of the world, they certainly don't want him. But the Lord Jesus, so the desire of all nations will come, and that desire is peace, but it won't come except by the Prince of Peace. And let's finish it. Psalm 76. Go to Psalm 76. And the first three verses, Psalm 76, verses 1, 2, and 3. In Judah is God known. His name is great in Israel. In Salem, that's going to be Jerusalem, also is his tabernacle, and his dwelling place in Zion. Then break he the arrows of the bow, the shield, and the sword, and the battle. Selah, those are all implements of war, all future events. One day, Israel won't need their Iron Dome technology. They won't need a standing army. They won't need to enlist all their citizens to go out and fight in their armed forces. It won't be necessary. Think of the Lord Jesus Christ ruling the world. His word will be the supreme law on planet Earth. And every glorified saint who comes back with him at the second coming, according to Joel chapter 2, is an indestructible army which, when it says fall upon a sword, they will not be hurt, neither shall one thrust them through. So you and I will then be made to be incorruptible, indestructible, and immortal, like the glorified body of the Lord Jesus. And if you can imagine the Lord Jesus ruling from a throne of splendor from the city of Jerusalem, a new temple is then built that will last for 1,000 years. It won't crumble or fall apart. And let's just guess, maybe 1 billion, perhaps more, of true believers who have then been transformed like the glorified image of Christ, enforcing his word throughout the world. There will the inventions of man, the ingenuity of man, he won't be able to create anything that could possibly bring assault the saints of Jesus Christ or the Lord Jesus Christ himself. Peace will be required. And the Lord Jesus Christ's absolute law, you and I, knowing what his absolute law is, and the image of Christ will spread out throughout the world in the form of the saints who have then been glorified. And if you're somebody left after the rapture, and you make it through into the millennium, or after the tribulation, make it through into the millennium, not having taken the mark, you won't be able to go anywhere without running into an image of Jesus Christ. With that many billions of transformed saints patrolling the earth for the Lord Jesus' sake. When the Bible says we shall reign with him, that's partly what it means. We will enforce his law, and it will be divine.